So first of all, it's an absolute honor to be here. University of Wisconsin, when I look out in the audience, I have more friends and people that I look up to and respect in this department probably than any department in the United States. And it's really an honor to visit a department with such a great culture around clinical excellence and academic development. So my talk today hopefully will be fun, and hopefully we can get a little more uplifting train of thought going here compared to the last hour. Two things before I get started. First, I do have a disclosure that I need to talk about. I am a co-founder of an informatics company, and I'm going to talk about some, there'll be a few slides that show some of our products, specifically around the Michigan Bariatric Surgery Collaborative, that we have a no-cost contract to do that because of our conflict of interest, but I need to disclose that. The second thing that I want to do before I get started is pass out some props. So I have an interactive portion of my lecture today, and I need to distribute some stuff. So Caprice, Gretchen, since you guys have done this before, I'm completely going to put you guys on the spot. So here, you've done this before. Oh, good. Well, I'm glad you don't remember. Oh, that's right. So just pass these out. Everyone should have two cards. And don't look at them, because we're going to use them later in the lecture. Don't look at them, don't read it, don't try and think about what it means. Just take two cards, probably one on each side of the auditorium. Two cards to everyone. And you can probably, you can just give them big chunks of cards and have them hand out, because we won't use them for a while. Yeah.
Just tell me what to do.
Well, I didn't realize you guys were going to take it so seriously. That's great, though. Yes, delegation. So great. So I want to start, since I know I was invited here to come to and participate in your resident research day. So I want to talk a little bit about my research journey, because what I'm going to talk about today, this idea of leadership and quality improvement, and the way there's different ways to approach quality and leadership, reflects kind of two things. One, my scientific journey and the way I've been working scientifically over time. The other thing is the lenses that I wear, and I think we all wear different lenses that we bring to the table. So I want to kind of set the stage by talking about those few things. Caprice mentioned I began my scientific career in the field of performance measurement, and I had this probably naive notion that if only we could decide how best to measure performance, things would magically align. Like, once we figured out how to measure quality, things would magically align, the ducks would line up, and everything would improve, and people would get better. Turns out that wasn't the case. Quality measures, as many of you know, and performance measures often collect dust on somebody's desk and aren't put into practice. So that got me really interested. Well, what we need is a hammer. We need to say, listen, you need to pay attention to those quality measures. So I got really interested in how you can incentivize people to care about quality measures. And so my research went from kind of figuring out the best way to measure quality to figuring out the best policy approach to make people care about quality. And what I learned there, and I'll show some of this work today, was that those top-down approaches don't always give you the best approach. They don't always give you the best answer. And so now, and stuff I'm working on now, is thinking about how to improve quality ourselves. So how do you implement change? And that leads me to the scientific areas of implementation science and the science of leadership, which is why I'm talking about that today. So the lenses that I wear a lot of different lenses, and we kind of all wear different hats. And I want to preface this today by kind of walking through the three hats that I wear, or the three primary hats, and that is as a minimally invasive and bariatric surgeon. We're surgeons, we all see the world through our kind of own clinical lens. And then I'm a scientist, I focus primarily on healthcare policy and outcomes, obviously. And then because of my interest in leadership has evolved beyond my research and into trying to figure out how to implement change more broadly, whether it's in our department or our region, et cetera, I've formed this faculty leadership development program, and that has been absolutely influential in terms of a lens of seeing the world. And that's what I want to help you see through that lens today. So from my clinical hat, this is where I start. When you look at this patient, this is not the kind of patient that we want to operate on, right? I mean, this patient is obese. You know they probably have obesity-related comorbidities. I know you guys are probably seeing, oh, look, a case. The bariatric surgeons, but everybody else, you know, we have this situation in bariatric surgery where we take a patient that nobody else wants to operate on, they have this profile of comorbidities, and then we do this to them. And there's a lot of staple lines there. There's a lot of surgery that happens with these bariatric operations and gastric bypasses. And my question to you, is that a safety problem? Now, how are we going to get patients through that operation safely? Sick patients, technically complex operation. Well, a few years ago, it was recognized to be a very bad safety problem. This is a paper from 2005, published by David Flum, which just documented mortality rates in Medicare patients and showed that in some hospitals, mortality rates were as high as 10% for a gastric bypass, for laparoscopic gastric bypass. Now, we'd recognize now that that's way too high, that's crazy, that is unsafe, and it kind of reflects my initial reaction when we saw that last slide. But what's happened? I think that the bariatric surgery story is a great lens to look at safety and quality through, because there has been a bigger improvement in the safety and the care of the delivery of bariatric surgery than any other clinical specialty in the last decade. And you can back that up with data. So in the state of Michigan, I know our data really well. This is what it is. So our mortality rate now is 0.003% for bariatric surgery. Our leak rates are now less than 1%. Bleeding, reoperation for bleeding is less than 1%. So a dramatic improvement in clinical care over the last decade. So that's one of the lenses that I want to look through today. This is another lens. And this is the lens of someone who thinks about quality and safety. This was one of my original motivations to get involved in this. When I was a medical student, I was a student at Johns Hopkins, and John Cameron was just then publishing some of the volume outcome relationship stuff for pancreatectomy. And as a student, it just blew my mind that there were tenfold variations in outcomes, in mortality rates across hospitals. Like, that was like a light bulb went off in my head, and I said, well, if I want to be useful in my life, I could probably try and shift that curve a little bit, or at least shine a light on that curve. And so that's one of the reasons that prompted me into this. Now, this curve, you know, the bell curve underlies everything in performance, whether it's tennis, you know, piano, surgery, everything. So half the people are above average and half the people are below average, even at a place like Wisconsin. So if I was to ask you, which half of you are in the bottom half? Raise your hand. Greg. So there's always a few like smart asses who raise their hands when I say that. But for the most part, most people don't raise their hand. Certainly not half the people raise their hand. So one of the things about this bell curve, we all know it's there, but it's invisible to most people. Most people don't have a good understanding of their own performance. I mean, I think we, at academic health centers, we like to think, well, if we're in the top half, everyone else is in the bottom half. Not always true when you look at the data. But one of the interesting things is this is, if we think it's invisible to us, it's completely invisible to the purchasers and consumers of healthcare. They have no ability to see this bell curve. But that's changing. And so looking at through the lens of healthcare policy, all of a sudden quality is starting to get teeth. You start to see more and more initiatives like these. Things where risk is shifting from the payer to the provider. And what do I mean by that? Well, the payer currently bears a lot of risk. If patients have a really bad outcome or in the ICU and you rack up charges, eventually you'll trigger enough healthcare resources so the payer ends up bearing the financial risk of that. With all these models we're talking about, non-payment for readmissions, non-payment for infections, episode-based bundled payments, accountable care organizations, which is essentially a more capitated healthcare model, all of a sudden we bear the risk. So all of a sudden that bell curve is becoming much more important. We need to start paying attention to it because people are starting to put teeth into it. So my final lens that I look through these issues on, or the issue of quality and value, is leadership. As Caprice mentioned, I put together and I run a development program for our mid-level faculty in leadership, working with the Ross School of Business at the University of Michigan. And I have learned a lot from that. Probably the biggest thing I learned was in watching them think about mental models. The way we think about mental models in healthcare, we think about them a lot. And all of our medical school, any medical students, are there medical students here? So in the medical school, they basically hammer into you these really complicated mental models for things like transmembrane receptors. Am I right? Yeah, they're all shaking their heads. So these are some kind of receptors thing. And what do we see? We see a bunch of colored bubbles, right? Is this what it really looks like? No. Is this how it really happens? No. It's a model, right? It's a mental model that we can use. Now, why do we have a mental model? Someone once said that all models are wrong, but some of them are useful. Well, we have mental models so that we can be useful and intervene on them to make a positive difference. And we teach students and residents these really complicated mental models, and we have the same thing for clinical behavior, but for leadership behaviors, we don't. The predominant mental model in surgery residency anyway, and what we teach is the strong versus weak, or good versus bad, you know, and a lot of times, as we saw in M&M Day, it's always us that's bad. Sometimes we're taught to fall on the sword. But in general, when you're dealing with complex interactions of people, it's more complicated than that. Mental models, and there are a set of mental models out there that you can use to help you understand yourself and your interactions, and to help you more effectively lead change. So that's kind of where I'm going with today. I'm going to take us through building a shared mental model of change. That's probably what's one of the top used mental models in the business world for how to go about understanding each other and implementing change. But just to make this a little more fun, I want to involve you in this. That's why I handed out the cards. Does everybody have cards? Now raise your hand if you don't. Okay. I do. But this is what we're going to do. Yeah, your turnout was really good here, but I do have more. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to take 5 minutes. You guys are such good helpers. We're going to take 5 minutes, okay? And some of you have two cards, some of you had one. We're going to pass out some more. What I want you guys to do is to mill about and talk to each other. I want to see some movement. I especially want to see the students and the residents and the faculty moving together. And I want you to try and come out of the next 5 minutes with one card that you think represents what's important to you in terms of your leadership style. Okay? You guys got that? So if those of you have two cards, give it to somebody, share. So there's a couple ways to do this. I want you to talk to people in exchange. The other thing is, if you have a card and you think that really is Dr. Kent, come give it to him. And it goes both ways. Usually the cards roll uphill. So if the students have a mentor, give it to them. So go ahead, take 5 minutes. Okay, everybody ready? Okay, everybody stop for a second. Look up here. Now, you're going to have to move because if you haven't figured it out yet, there's four colors here, and I'm going to separate you guys by your colors. All right, because then we're going to have a little interaction going on with those four kind of teams. So, how many people have more than one card still? Okay. So everyone with more than one card, I want you to take the card that you think of the cards you have represents you. So you're down to a single color. All right. So everyone should have one color. And then you're going to go sit according to that color. So everybody who has a red card, stand up and move over here. Down to this right corner. All right? Yeah. What's that?
I have four red cards.
You have four?
Four red cards.
Not something to brag about. Okay. If you have a blue card, over here. Blue. Over here. And you can be, are you blue? You're not. So green is up there in the top, and yellow's over here. All right, how are we doing here? You guys are a wily bunch. Yeah, no. Okay, red over here. You guys got red? Yeah.
Two people gave me this card.
You should go there. You're blue. Oh, then you stay here. You stay here. Red. You guys greens? You guys greens? Oh, yellows, perfect. Yellows, all right, yellows. What are you guys?
Yellow.
Yellow, okay. This should be a little more that way, but you're okay. And this is green.
And blue. Are you blue? Are you blue? You guys blue? Excellent. All right. All right, okay. Okay, you guys ready? Everybody sit down, find a seat. Well, let's see. Red, yellow, a lot of yellows, red, and blue, right? Okay. So now I know you guys are thinking, well, where's he going with this? Now, this model, these colors, support this really wonderful idea of leadership and creating value in organizations from this book. I'm always hesitant when I put a book up there because a couple of years ago, when I read Jim Collins' Good to Great, I thought I learned a lot. I sent an email to some of my friends, and one of them quickly replied back. My friend, who's a lot like Jake Greenberg, quickly replied back, just think what a great leader you'll be when you've read two books. So I'm always hesitant to talk about a book, but this one, as I said, it's a useful mental model. And I think it starts with this idea of defining leadership as something that is kind of a broad concept, because there's a lot of definitions. But in my mind, leadership is adding value to an organization. It isn't being the chair, being the division chief, etc. It's just figuring out some way to add value to your organization. And this exercise helps you understand in which way you add value to an organization, or which predominant role or leadership style you bring to the table in terms of adding value. So these are the quadrants. So the green folks, which are you guys, Greg's up there, all right? I made some predictions here, so we'll see how close I am. So people who gravitate to those cards tend to be innovative, out-of-the-box thinkers, and they add value to an organization by generating new ideas. So some of you guys read your cards. Greg? There you go. Creative experiments. Somebody else?
Encouraging entrepreneurship.
I had a feeling you'd be there, Carla. Anybody else?
Articulating future possibilities for the organization.
Somebody else?
Strategizing change.
Right, so you get the idea there. New ideas, change. So innovators are in the green folks. Now the yellow folks, which seems to be a lot of people here, these are the warm and cuddlies. These are the people that focus on relationships. So not ideas, but relationships and understanding relationships. So some of you guys read your cards. Becky?
Hiring good people.
Good people.
Fostering empowerment.
Hey, Melnick.
Increasing
morale. So obviously, the idea here is it's harmony. It's working and worrying about the people in the organization, optimizing them. People who land in that quadrant often tend to be, in an organization would be human resources. In the Department of Surgery tend to be clerkship directors, and program directors tend to be there because they're worried about the people and the experience. Dr. Foley, are you? Mentoring and coaching people. Did somebody give you that?
No.
You have. That's good. I'd like to say I planned that, but program directors tend to always end up in the yellow part of the quadrant. Okay, the blue folks. Now, this is where my heart is, because every time I do this, I come out as blue. But this is people who compete. They're driven, they're competitive, they bring that to the organization. So that's how they add value. A lot of chairs sitting down in this quadrant, usually. A lot of division chiefs sitting in this quadrant, which is what I see here. You guys read your cards.
Focusing on goal attainment
was given to you.
Was given, yes.
By a medical student. Yeah. Sharon, what do you have?
Emphasizing short time to market.
Short time to market. So, Jake?
Making decisions quickly.
I was surprised. I thought you'd be in the warm and cuddly.
My wife gave it to me.
Okay. No, this isn't supposed to be aspirational, Caprice. So, now the red folks. So red folks tend to bring value to an organization by focusing on compliance. We know what to do, we just got to make you do it right. So what do you guys have?
Cutting costs.
Good. Herb, not surprised to see you here.
Emphasizing efficiency.
Efficiency, all right.
Optimizing processes.
Processes, so you're optimizing processes.
Increasing productivity.
Productivity, all right. Well, You know, another way, so you kind of understood the behaviors that underlie this. Another way to think about these quadrants or these ways to add value to organization is on archetypes. And these are kind of some classic archetypes. You know, Einstein was obviously the great creative genius. Gandhi is probably the most, you know, the person that represents the collaborative spirit and caring about people and effecting change through those methods. Control, you know, that it's kind of military, efficiency, precision. So Patton is a good example of someone who's an archetype of that. In blue, a lot of surgeons tend to end up there. So here we have, you know, Denton, Cooley, and DeBakey on the cover of Life magazine having a feud. So surgeons. Now, this slide, there's a couple things in the slide that I think are worth noting. First is that, you know, this isn't all positive, right? Each one of these is a way to add value, but you can start to see that each one of these styles or leadership approaches has an Achilles heel. And you start to see a little bit with Einstein, right? Two things are infinite, the universe and human stupidity. I'm not so sure about the universe, right? So he's not a lot of patience, not a lot of willingness to, not a lot of respect for the status quo or the people who are responsible for maintaining the status quo. So interestingly, those people would be exactly across on the other quadrant. And that's why this is called a competing values, because all these things are important. It's obvious. We need all these things in our organization, right? And there's a natural tension across from one quadrant to the other. Right? People who are innovative are constantly at odds with people who are trying to do it the same way every time because it's efficient and it's compliant, right? The people who are warm and cuddly are sometimes at odds with the people who are the most competitive. So there's this natural cross-quadrant tension between these. So these are some of my predictions. Some of them are right. Some of them are wrong. I think I got Dr. Kent right. I was pretty sure Herb would be over here, but I think, you know, the efficiency card, I could imagine you over there. Greg, I put under control, not because I don't think you're creative, but because you're the associate chair of quality, right? And a lot of quality folks, people who are in charge of making sure we get our skip antibiotics and all that stuff on time, tend to be in the control and compliance quadrant. Second card was red, okay. I did this once with a bunch of healthcare executives, and all the chief medical officers were in the red quadrant. I put Caprice and Gretchen up in the creative quadrant. Are you guys anywhere near there? Yes, there you are. Perfect. Okay, there you are. So in the green quadrant. And I put Jake. I still think you're more warm and cuddly, but...
I just collaborated by listening.
And Dr. Foley, who I sat next to at dinner last night. Usually I only put people that I know really well up here because I don't want to offend anybody. But I talked to Dr. Foley a lot at dinner last night, and it was clear that he's up there in the yellow quadrant. So... You know, these are kind of archetypal. They're obviously, it's a model, right? It's not right, but it could be useful. So one interesting way of thinking about this cross-collaborate tension is to think about how the people across here view you, right? So how blue, the competitive folks, might see the warm and cuddlies, right? This slide says, collaboration, I'm smarter than you are, and you're really just slowing me down. So that could be one way to view it. How red, the people who are interested in compliance and efficiency might see the green folks. You know, you're up here trying to innovate and, you know, that's not that useful. Just do some RVUs for me, please. Another good one, how the yellow folks might see the blue. This gets back to that joke that if you're being chased by a bear, you don't need to be faster than a bear, just faster than your friend. And then how green... The innovators may see red. You're a box checker. You're slowing me down. You're not promoting innovation, etc. So that's just another way of thinking about the cross-quadrant collaboration or cross-quadrant tension. So the other thing I wanted to stress with a little story is that none of these are good and bad. And I kind of alluded to that a little bit. Every side, every color, every strategy, every style has its downside. And so this is, once again, Cooley and DeBakey on the cover of Life magazine. Does anyone know why they're on the cover of Life magazine? You must know. You remember this, the feud?
I remember the feud, yeah.
You remember the feud. So they were on the cover of Life magazine because of a lifelong feud that started when Dr. Cooley was working kind of in the lab of Dr. DeBakey. And they were working on something very exciting. It was the total artificial heart. And Dr. DeBakey had... NIH funding to work on this, and they were moving towards human trials. And one time, when Dr. DeBakey was going around out of town, Dr. Cooley took the heart and put it in the first patient. And that obviously, that would get him in big trouble now with the NIH, but it got him in some trouble then. And he actually went to court and had to defend his actions. And when he was on the stand, the lawyer was cross-examining him and said, you know, Dr. Cooley, why did you do that? Why would you take that heart and put it in someone? And Dr. Cooley responded, well, I thought the world's best surgeon should do the first total artificial heart. And the lawyer said, Dr. Cooley, don't you think that's so immodest? Dr. Cooley replied, yes, but I am under oath. So, once again, every one of these sides has its downside. And this chart kind of shows, flipping back again to the positive side, this is how you add value in each one of those quadrants. And I think you'll see, for those of you who ended up there, that you may be sitting in a role, if you're in a leadership role, that kind of reflects that value. So, obviously, the blue people tend to be producers and directors. They're division chiefs, chairs. People in the red tend to be chief medical officers, compliance officers, those sorts of roles. People in yellow tend to be mentors and facilitators. Program directors is probably the best example. And then the green people tend to be the innovators and the idea brokers. Obviously, this is an academic department of surgery. Everybody sits in all of these domains and wears all these different hats. This is just, a model for thinking about these things. Now, what does this have to do with quality? So I would argue, and this is one thing that on reflecting on this model became apparent to me, was that improving quality and adding value improving quality is really just adding value. And if you write larger than the individual and the influence of the individual on the organization, and you think about what the goal is of an academic surgeon, what do you guys think? What's the goal? It's to write a lot of papers with high impact factor, right? And to get a lot of grants. No? What is it? Dr. Kent, what do you think?
Take really good care of patients and advance healthcare.
So, right. So, and I would summarize that basically by saying to be useful. To be useful and move our field forward, whether it's one patient at a time, whether it's entire clinical program, whether it's through training the next generation, or whether through it's pushing your field forward through new ideas. So all of those things, if you treat organized surgery or organized healthcare as our organization, our goal is to add value to that system. And so I think that these are the same models that we can use to add value to our profession through our work as academic surgeons. And this gets a little bit back to my very first slide where I talked about my own research trajectory and my growth and kind of thinking about how I can influence change and move the world forward in my specialty and more broadly. So, you know, these are the ways in which, you know, that this value creation can be translated to that larger scale by focusing on ideas, relationships, by focusing on results and focusing on the best outcomes, and by focus on compliance with standards. So I want to walk through some evidence and talk about some of the, you know, which works and which doesn't work and why things do and don't work from each of those examples. But I think that one of the take-home points, and I alluded to this on the personal and organizational level, is the secret to each one of these value creation modes is to balance with the other side. I think that if you were to define leadership or affecting change or being effective as a change agent in one word, I think that one word would be empathy. It would be understanding other people's perspectives. And the nice thing about this model is it basically shows you or helps you start to understand the other person's perspective, other people who add value in a different way. Because when you're sitting down with someone and you're talking about, you know, having the best X program in the world, and you're talking to someone over here, they may be thinking the first thing on their mind is, how does that impact the people? How does it impact the residents? How does it impact the students? How does it impact the people? And both are good ideas and both need to be done, but you have to come together in an empathic way to make that happen. So once again, this model I think is useful to help you see that, and I want to walk you through some example of things that have worked and things that haven't worked and why the undoing of any strategy in change is always because it failed to take into account the other perspective. So a lack of empathy. So let's think for a second. And from a competition perspective, what are the best ways to use that this way of adding value or adding improving quality? Ideas? Jake?
Make your results visible.
So public reporting, a great strategy, widely used, has been effective in some contexts, not others, and not effective in others. So here we're talking about competing on results, right? So there's a lot of examples here. Pay for performance, centers of excellence, public reporting is another good one. And you don't have to look very far to see the downsides of some of those programs, right? Especially the public reporting. There's a lot of unintended consequences that can happen when you do that. But the example I want to use is, once again, I said I'm going to use the minimally invasive surgery and the bariatric surgery lens, is the Medicare coverage decision. So for those of you, probably most of you know about this, but a few years ago, ACS and our leading bariatric organization started accrediting centers of excellence for bariatric surgery. And Medicare issued a national coverage decision where they said, we will only pay for surgery if it's in one of those centers. Now, this was never done before in surgery. Obviously, those of us who have published a bunch of volume outcome papers earlier in our career were really excited about this because it was somebody using our data to improve the world. So we all thought it was great. And I actually secured my first R01 grant to evaluate whether or not this policy and a bunch of other healthcare policies, once again, getting back to my research trajectory, how they impact surgery and whether or not they work. So I was excited. We did a very rigorous health policy analysis of this bariatric surgery center of excellence program to see, I figured it would work. It wasn't really to see whether or not it worked or not. It was to see how much it worked, just how great this idea was. And unfortunately, what we showed was that bariatric surgery quality, as I mentioned before, has improved a lot. Outcomes have gotten way better, probably accelerated at an unprecedented rate in surgery over the last 10 years. But the problem is that happened long before anybody put the Center of Excellence program into play. So this data shows three outcomes, any complication, serious complication, and reoperation before and after that Center of Excellence policy was implemented. That policy is the dotted line kind of about halfway through the time frame there. And you can see there's an acceleration or an improvement in outcomes, right? But the slope starts headed down way before that Center of Excellence policy. And the studies before this had just done kind of a pre-post study. And if you did that, you could see outcomes are better. But if you actually take into account that things are getting better in the background, it had no benefit. And moreover, if you look at the Centers of Excellence versus non-Centers of Excellence, they didn't have better outcomes. This slide just shows outcomes at COEs and non-COEs with the odds ratios for all those outcomes circling around 1. So basically not much better. The other downside of any policy like that is that it can have human effects. It can have unintended consequences that play out poorly for all the seems disadvantaged patients, the most vulnerable people. And we were able to demonstrate that the minority-serving hospitals did not achieve the COE credential, and patients in those hospitals therefore stopped getting bariatric surgery or stopped having access to bariatric surgery. Now, if you accept that bariatric surgery is a good thing, which I think most surgeons would agree on at this point, that's limited access to a care. And this slide basically shows a similar graphs I showed you before, but this time it's access to care and rates of surgery in minorities and non-minorities, and you can see the minority patients drop off in Medicare, but don't in non-Medicare. So it basically is, since the policy only applied to Medicare patients, it was easiest for us to tease out that policy impacted vulnerable populations in a bad way. And because of this, and I think other data, CMS ended up eliminating the bariatric surgery facilitation certification requirement. So they overturned this great model of using competition. So why didn't it work? Well, if you look at the data, not a lot happened to improve quality in the centers that became COEs. They were a little bit bigger to start with, but what happened is a lot of hospitals that were kind of just below the threshold bumped their volumes up by doing an incremental number of bands. And so what you see is gaming. So most people became COEs because they had the money to do it and they were already high volume, or they gained the system a little bit and became a center of excellence. A lot of places that had great quality didn't become COEs. And so it was this implementation of a good idea that in practice ended up affecting gaming more than it did quality. People didn't fundamentally say, okay, we need to become a COE, let's reorganize care. And I think that's one of the downsides of these competition approaches is they encourage unintended consequences, like not operating on sick patients in cardiac, which was seen in cardiac surgery in New York, or in kind of gaming the system so you look good enough to get the credential, but you don't step back and say, let me improve my care and reorganize care. So thinking about innovation, how does innovation improve quality? Greg, what do you think? How do we use innovation? Yeah. Right. Now, for me, this is one of those things that just is so obvious, you know, you don't even need to say it, right? I mean, this is part of surgery, right? New technology, laparoscopy, robots, in my profession, whatever it is, it's constantly introduced. So we don't even need to say this, really. New technology is a big driver of care. So the positive side here, I think, is completely obvious to everybody. It's the downside that I think is something we really need to think about, especially since we have tight relationships with industry, and industry is always promoting the uptake of new technology. And so I think we need to be careful. We have to be constantly safeguard ourselves in the technology and using innovation to take a step back and make sure that we're doing this in an evidence-based way. Now, if you think about the quadrants, once again, what's opposite innovation? It's control and compliance. It's making sure that we're compliant with, if you're starting a new company or have a new product we want to take to market, we need to think about the tech transfer office and the compliance office and making sure we're compliant with that. I think if it's a new technology procedure, we need to make sure that we have evidence before we implement it too widely. And in my field, lap band is the story that I think kind of spread too far before we had great evidence, especially around long-term outcomes. So I don't have the final data on this yet, but I think there were more bands taken out in the United States last year than put in. If not, it's getting close. It's getting very close. Jake's shaking his head, so it has face validity. So what did we learn about the band? Well, the band, it's very safe to do. You just put it in, it takes 20 minutes, one stitch. But there's long-term downstream complications. The band erodes, it slips on the stomach. We're now seeing studies demonstrating 20 to 30% erosion rates and 50% weight loss failure rates for the band. Something that doesn't really work that well. It's having all kinds of problems, and we didn't really know about it. A few years ago, it was almost getting close to 50% of bariatric surgery, and now it's down to, at least in Michigan, about 2%. So I think the best way to use research and to do academic work and add value to this world is to demonstrate this long-term effectiveness of the band. Now, when we wrote this grant, bands were probably 20 to 30%, and it got funded when bands were about 1%. So it's one of those things where it's almost a little too late, but eventually, you know, we're doing this work now to use national Medicare claims to generate this data, to get this long-term effectiveness data. So once again, a way to use research to add value. So how do we use control and compliance to add value to healthcare? What are the best ways to do that? So thinking quality here, not RVU targets, Herb.
Well, probably the examples that
Right, so exactly right. So compliance with guidelines is probably the best way to demonstrate this. And I want to give a little background information for my next example because it involves a collaborative quality improvement program in the state of Michigan called the Michigan Bariatric Surgery Collaborative. For those of you who aren't familiar with these programs, Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan, which is a dominant payer in our state, has about 80% of the private payer marketplace, pays about $30 million a year to support quality improvement collaboratives. There's 14 of them now, one of which is bariatric surgery that's run by Nancy Berkmeyer. And the idea is to identify these best practices, as Herb said, and implement them in practice and increase their compliance with them. It's kind of the underlying drive for this. But it's really about learning from real data and having real data to bring to bear. And these are just an example of some of the outcomes profiles that we can do. And we have these type of things which you'll be familiar with are kind of NISQIP graphs, which tell you where you rank in terms of outcomes. We also track, as you see, and this is why I put the slide up here, we track compliance to guidelines for surgeons across the state in bariatric surgery. So the example I want to give is what the benefits you can accrue by standardizing care across, say, an entire state. And obviously this wouldn't be useful, or you wouldn't be able to do this without a good data registry and without a collaborative or an agreement or a collection of surgeons coming together to work on this. But we, a couple years ago, when we first launched the MBSC, we took a poll of what people did for VTE prophylaxis around bariatric surgery, and this is what we found. Now, you don't need to focus on what anything means except that each color is a different strategy, and each line is a different hospital. So you can see that there was wide variation in what people did, and even within hospitals about how they did it. So what we did was we basically used our data, because we had good data on outcomes, to understand which practices work and which ones don't, and then we developed a guideline. Now, it's now a user support module in our software, but at this point it was actually a card that we laminated and gave to surgeons, and then we talked about it and we measured their compliance with these best practice guidelines. And this is an example of the audited and overall compliance with those guidelines. You can see them going from 30% up to 70 or 80% in 2011. They're up to around 90% at this point. Well, did that work? The answer is yes. VTE rates in the state of Michigan fell more than half over this timeline. And we also saw deaths go down in a significant way, and even faster than deaths were going down in bariatric surgery across the nation. And as we know, a lot of deaths after bariatric surgery, at least in our collaborative, more than 50% are due to PE. So this slide here demonstrates our collaborators' mortality rates in the orange line and the NISQIP, or kind of the national benchmark rates, in the red line. So we were able to accelerate improvement using just a simple standardization to a guideline. Now, I'd argue that we didn't just send this to people. There was a lot of social capital building that went on as well, so it's not a strictly red solution in that it took place in this collaborative. So, yellow folks, how do we use collaboration? And obviously, I'm leading in from talking about a collaborative to talking about accelerating that collaboration. Any ideas? Yeah, that's actually a great one. So this one, once again, is almost self-evident, but building on the collaborative experience with the VTE prophylaxis, what we learned from that was that you can get people to agree on doing something, but it takes both strategies to do that, because it takes both the collaboration and the compliance. But one thing we learned was we looked at our rates of VTE, we got those low, we worked on SSIs, but there were still a lot of complications after bariatric surgery, and a lot of them were technical. And so we started to think, well, maybe we need to get a little more creative. We need to figure out a way to start focusing on what happens in the operating room and understanding the technique and the skill and improve that. So we did something a little risky and something that relied tremendously on social capital. And social capital meaning the relationships that we developed with surgeons throughout this collaborative. When we started, everybody came in, they were very skeptical, nobody wanted to share data, there was very little buy-in, and that's why we started with something like a laminated card for VTE. But as the collaborative went on, and we got to know each other, and we played tennis together, and we drank beers together, there started to develop camaraderie of surgeons across the state. There's only 40 bariatric surgeons in the state. We all got to know each other pretty well. We called people when we had a hard case. We traded patients when people didn't have the resources at their hospitals to take care of certain patients with certain complications. So we'd really developed a true collaborative. And that facilitated us doing kind of what I'd say higher level collaborative improvement work. So, and we started to get people to send videos. Now, at the beginning, if we'd asked people to send a video of them operating, never would happen. But after you built the social capital, they sent us their videos, and we were able to start studying technical skill. So what we did was every surgeon submitted their typical gastric bypass case. So what did we get? We got everybody's best case, right? Everyone sent us their best case of that year. And we did a blinded peer rating. We used an online software system to do a OSATS-like video assessment that basically assessed 6 different domains of technical skill and then an overall kind of gestalt skill level. And we had about 10 raters per video from across the state. This is just an example of the OSATs. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with that. And we found 2 really interesting things. First, technical skill just varied a ton across practicing surgeons in Michigan. And this is all for gastric bypass procedures, which is obviously a technically complex procedure. Each one of these lines is a surgeon, and you can see they varied from an average rating on a scale of 5 from 2.5 to a 5. I think one thing you'll notice here is that the confidence or the distribution around the worst surgeon and the best surgeon is really tight. It's really tight. So there was really good agreement on the best and the worst, and you know, there's less certainty in the middle, but it was still pretty consistent across surgeons. The interrelator reliability was very high. So the second interesting thing we found was that these skill ratings correlate really strongly with outcomes. So if you take those 3 groups and divide them up into a bottom, middle, and a top skill group and calculate outcomes, this is what you see. So 2 or 3-fold differences in almost every outcome you studied across surgeon skill ratings. So this was a pretty seminal finding, which is probably why New England Journal published it, but they really made us bulletproof it before we got published. This is the only paper I've been involved with that took a year for us to come back, get all the videos re-rated. We got second videos from everybody. We sent it to surgeons outside Michigan because they wanted us to assess interrelator reliability up and down and backwards to make sure this held up, and it did. Because this is pretty important. It basically tells us that your peers' rating of your skill is a stronger predictor of outcome than pretty much anything else we've ever seen. It's stronger than volume. I'll tell you, fellowship training didn't matter in this model. You know, there was no difference in skill and no different in outcomes for fellowship training. These are all people who've been in an average of practice about 10 years. So I suspect if you look the year after. But frankly, you just don't see non-fellowship trained surgeons doing bariatrics unless they proctored on 500 cases, where they scrub with their partners for the first couple of years, at least in Michigan. So a very profound finding. And then, but the question is, what do you do with that? So unlike the VTE prophylaxis, okay, we have high VTE rates, everybody use prophylaxis, right? That's kind of easy. But how do you improve skill? And so this is where I say that my research ended up circulating back to Caprice's work. And she'd been working on this for a very long time. And you know, I pulled up this article and reread it. And this is an article that Atul Gawande published that largely focused on some work that Caprice was doing at Harvard at the time. And it basically raises this question of, in every other type of situation where peak physical performance is necessary, like sports and music, everybody has a coach. And why don't surgeons have coaches? And one of the most compelling models that Atul talked about here was this kind of lifelong learner versus kind of apprenticeship-style learning where, and this is probably based on Caprice's work too, he probably got this idea from her, but basically this idea that surgical training is treated as if it's 5 years and you're done, or 5 years plus 2 years, whatever it is, you're done, go out and be on your own. You know, that's kind of the model. You're board certified. You're kind of finished. Versus the model of we need to continually improve ourselves over time and get coached. Now, one of the interesting things I heard from the case today, you know, you had your case there with that was questionable and you didn't know, so you called your partners in. And that's a great example of this. And we know that all good surgeons do this anyway. They ask for help, they get coaching, they get advice on their tough cases, but not everybody does it. And so making it a formal part of your training and learning and creating an infrastructure to make it easier so people who are isolated or alone can have some way of doing it is obviously a good idea. And so we call it Caprice. And recently happy to see this used to have a picture of Brett Bielema on it, but now has Bo Ryan. You know, we came to Caprice, and she obviously had been working on this Wisconsin surgical coaching model. And we thought we had a nice match here with her understanding of the coaching model and our infrastructure and skill assessment to write a nice grant. So we worked together, and we wrote probably the biggest money-wise R01 grant that I've written before. And it basically is to implement a coaching program, essentially it's the Wisconsin surgical coaching model, in our collaborative to improve skill and outcomes. Skill being this aim 2, and aim 3 being to actually assess the impact of that coaching on risk-adjusted outcomes. So a really exciting project that we're just getting started on. One of the fun things about this is going to be thinking about how to train the coaches. And once again, I know Caprice is working on that now in Wisconsin with some of you or the coaches. But this is a fun process to think about, how do you prepare someone to better coach so we don't get, you know, this level of intensity. That wouldn't go over well in our collaborative, I don't think. So one of the other interesting things about using the collaborative approach, and why I think it's really the highest yield approach for improving quality, is that it can be generative. It's not, ideas can be emergent from the process. It's not, we know how to do VTE, do that. It is people figuring out how to do it together and ultimately come out with a better way of doing things. And the best example I can give of that is sleeve gastrectomy. So right now, sleeve in Michigan went from 4% in 2010 to 70% of bariatric operations. And everyone in our collaborative agrees, we're not really sure what the best way to do it is. We're not sure how close to get to the GE junction. We're not sure how big to make it, how tight to make it on the bougie, what size bougie to use. So one of the really interesting things that we're moving forward on now is to use videos to assess technique. So we're basically going to use the same peer rating of skill to assess technique. And the difference between skill and technique, at least as I see it, is, you know, skill is how well you do it. Technique is how you do it in the first place. So we're now going to do a similar study that we did on bypass, but do it with sleeve and focus on both skill and technique and try and understand which aspects of technique relate to short and long-term outcomes, and then once again to implement best practices statewide. So a fun, well, I think an innovative way to generate new knowledge and use a collaborative to do that. So this is my summary slide. And I just want to go through each quadrant and kind of talk about two things. One, just review how that they add value, but also talk about that Achilles heel, because I think that's the problem with a lot of thinking through these quality improvement strategies and adding value. So I think center of excellence models will work. They'll probably work best for rare conditions, just for the practical reasons like pancreatectomy, esophagectomy. It surprises me that Medicare started with bariatric surgery and not rare cancer operations. I don't know why they wouldn't have done that first. But I think it'll work. But I think you really need to make sure you don't just get gaming. Because if you get people gaming the system, then value has not been created. You've just moved deck chairs around the Titanic, as someone said earlier this morning. So innovation and new ideas and new technology and new approaches, new procedures, I think are a great way to add value. That's probably one of the biggest, you know, ways that surgery has improved in the last decade, with laparoscopy and endovascular technology. You know, new technology has revolutionized all of our fields. But you need to make sure that you have good evidence before it disseminates too widely, or at the very least develop evidence as it's disseminating so we have a good answer before something gets too far disseminated and causes patient harm. And I use the lap band as that example in my own field. I think control and compliance is a great way to improve quality and add value, but it sets a low bar because there's no new information generated. You're saying, based on what we know from the literature, you should do that. But once again, I think that's entry-level performance. And why I think that collaborative quality improvement is the best way that we as surgeons can add value to our lives, for two reasons. One, because it's very engaging to surgeons. When we show these videos and we show the best videos, surgeons love it. They're really engaged. They really want to talk about them and learn from each other. But once again, that requires social capital in developing those networks and spending time on developing those networks. I think the most powerful way that these collaboratives can then add value is by generating new knowledge, things that we didn't know before that can come out of those kind of evidence generation processes. So that's all I have. I thank you all for inviting me here. It's going to be a great day, I'm sure.